Good morning. So we continue our lectures, and the last topic which was started on the previous lecture is Kelly transform and other representation of homogeneous spaces for SL to R. So probably you may remember Kelly transform from the course of complex analysis. So briefly, it's introduced as follow. We have two classical domains for complex analysis that may be the upper half plane, or it can be the unit disk. And there is Möbius map, which translate one domain into another. So it's called Kelly transform. And it's given by matrix conjugation with the matrix of the form 1i1. Actually, we may want to normalize this matrix to have determinant equal to 1 by dividing by square root of 2, but in most cases, for simplicity, I will forget that factor. So having such a matrix, we are making matrix conjugation for elements of our group A, the cell to R, which has a form ABCD with real numbers, by this Kelly transform matrix. So inverse will be just this one on the right. So, and if we have such a product, if we will calculate what is the result, so it will be a matrix of the form alpha beta, beta bar, alpha bar, where alpha and beta are complex numbers. So starting from A, B, C, D, we obtain some matrix always with such structure with complex entries alpha and beta, and condition for the determinant of matrix ABCD equal to 1 is equivalent to the condition what determinant of this matrix is equal to 1, but determinant of this matrix is alpha in absolute value square root minus beta in absolute value square root is equal to 1 as well. So we probably need to put 1/2, that is come from these two square roots, in order to have corresponding identities. And in particular, what a consequence of this identity is what alpha in absolute value is always bigger than beta. So a consequence of this identity. So then that Kelly transform has many important interesting properties. In particular, what we have replaced domain of our holomorphity from upper half plane, which is unbounded domain, to the nice compact representation, the unit disk. So something which we can imagine controlling better than infinite upper half plane. So this is the main reason probably of this Kelly transform in various applications. Otherwise, geometry of these two domains, of course, are equivalent. And so in particular, we have transformation of any corresponding group action as on the homogeneous space. So let's just remind our general construction, how we describe the action of a group on the on the corresponding homogeneous spaces. So we consider a certain embedding S of a homogeneous space into the group when we produce left action and when we make projection of corresponding homogeneous space. This is how action is defined. And in order to get that action, we need a certain representation. We want to represent our group G as a set product of other sets, product of a set X with some subgroup H which we are factorizing. For SL2R, in this case, the decomposition look like that. That formula shall be reverted in other way around. So beta we will say what alpha beta beta bar alpha bar is equal to the 1 u bar 1 times e to the power e omega 0 0 e to the power e omega minus. So beta we have this decomposition. Then this element, as easy to see, is belong to subgroup K, because if we were making such a decomposition for a matrix cosine omega sine omega minus sine omega cosine omega with these matrices 1 minus i minus i 1, then result will be exactly that matrix, probably just with some factor 2, which shall be added somewhere to this calculation. So subgroup K is represented by such diagonal matrices. This diagonalization is key advantage of the Kelly transform in our case. So if we have such a decomposition, then it's turned out what element U here just has a norm less than 1, so it's belong to the unit disk, because its representation is beta divided by alpha in absolute value. And as we said from this identity for determinants, absolute value of alpha is bigger than absolute value of beta. So U belong point in the homogeneous space, which parameterize cosets, belong to the unit disk. And here, it's maybe worth to say what although that matrix conjugation provide the group homomorphism, so this is essentially the same group, but names after such transformation is changed. If in the left hand side we have our well used name SL2R, the matrices which is on the right hand side is known as special unitary group in complex numbers with signature 1 1. So it's just because matrices of this form preserve corresponding complex valued quadratic form with signature 1 1. So this is explained with name as U11. So more properly, when we have this complex valued matrices, speak about this group, so it will be more standard. But it's worth again to remember what this is actually equivalent groups. In particular, SL2R has different appearance. Again, I just mentioned it on occasion. It's not immediately connected to what we are doing now, but this is a special orthogonality group with a signature of a metric being 2 1. So that is like reduced Minkowski space-time symmetry of such group. Okay, so what that Kelly transform is doing for corresponding action, again, this is exactly homomorphism to our between two groups, so action on homogeneous space is isomorphic, but we may see what picture is apparently different. So if you look on the action of subgroup K in the upper half plane, this is with isometric rotation of Lobachevsky half plane with corresponding distance, Lobachevsky distance in the upper half plane. But after Kelly transform, it became usually isometries with respect to Euclidean distances. So here orbits became just circle, concentric circle, and disk is rotated around the origin. So this is what we have on the disk picture. So action of SL to R in this disk model is much simpler just because to this fact of diagonalization. So corresponding element of subgroup K act as diagonal matrices, so it's just multiplication in Möbius transformation. But pictures for them to other groups, one parameter groups like A and N, different. So N in the upper half plane is horizontal shifts. So now we have wet concentric orbits, and orbits was parallel line, horizontal lines. Now it became the orbits became circles, which are tangent to the unit disk in the point I, that point I representing the infinity after Kelly transform, which is image of infinity. So here parallel lines are meeting at infinity, and moreover in the model of conformal Riemannian sphere, the parallel lines at infinity not only meets, any line, straight line meets at infinity, parallel line in infinity are tangent. So this is how we can distinguish by their behavior at infinity, parallel line from crossing line. So any line past infinity, but parallel line are tangent where. And so here, for example, we can see straight lines for orbit of action subgroup A on the upper half plane, which is dilation. So we just expand or shrink the corresponding geometrical objects. On the unit disk, this parallel line, this straight line, which originate at the zero, so they now arcs of circles which pass minus I, which image of origin in the upper half plane, and meet again each other at the I, point I, which is the image of infinity. So this is just how Kelly transform map that action of three subgroups from upper half plane to the unit disk. So this ELSA suggests the following consideration, that we have for SL to R, two rather important decomposition. So we have Iwasawa decomposition. Which represent SL to R are the product of A, N, and K. So if we will use the decomposition to represent the homogeneous space SL to R over K, we can say what it's more or less like AN. A is dilation and R shifts, so that AN is the group of affine transformation of the upper half plane. So coming back to this picture, so A act as dilation and act by shift, and actually that AN nicely parameterize upper half plane, because we can parameterize arbitrary point X, Y as follow. We may just treat it as, because affine group acts on the upper half plane simply transitively. Transitively means what it's translate any given point, say I, to any other given point, say xy, with transitivity. But simply transitivity means what it's translated one point to another in the unique way. So it's just one transformation which map pair of given points from one to another. And so we may represent it as follow. We first dilate our plane to map I to I y, so we made dilation by y, and then we do the shift by x, so we then make transformation by x, so we will, after dilation and shift, we come to the point xy. So this is how affine group parameterize upper half plane. But besides of Iwasawa decomposition for SL to R, in representation theory of this group, another decomposition also is important. It's known as Cartan decomposition. And it represents SL to R in the form KAK. So subgroup N is not appearing here, but it's not so important which groups are appearing. It's more helpful in the language of corresponding homogeneous spaces. So in particular, that means what SL to R over K with homogeneous space can be parameterized by the action of subgroup A and K. So action of subgroup A and K is give us polar coordinates. So here we will come back to Iwasawa decomposition and the upper half plane that give us Cartesian coordinates. It gives Cartesian coordinates of the upper half plane. And the decomposition, Cartan decomposition, really means the polar coordinates of the unit disk. So that produces polar coordinates of the unit disk. So just a look on the action of subgroup A. So that is how we parameterize the our unit disk. So if we will look on the action of subgroup A, we will see what among all these orbits, which are arcs of circles passing points minus I and I, there is that straight line which just joining these two points. Straight line is passed through the zero. So action of A, so A send zero to given point with coordinates R times I, where so it's A act here to the point Ri. So where R may be positive or negative. So R here treated from minus one, strictly from minus one to one. Again, not included. And after that, after we use subgroup A to shift vertically, again, our point zero. So subgroup K act by the rotation. So when K send R I to the point with R times E I omega. So polar representation. So if we will look again how subgroup K is acting, it's exactly rotation with preservation of the radius. So if you will compare, so two pictures with coordinates, polar coordinates and Cartesian coordinates on the corresponding upper half plane. So we have rather explicit similarity. So that decomposition in terms of two remaining groups, so Ka here and An here, A act in vertical direction in both case, and then additional coordinates is produced by the second group, either subgroup N or subgroup K in this case. So two types of coordinates on the geometrical complex geometrical objects are really manifest themselves in corresponding important decomposition of a SL2R group, corresponding homogeneous space. So Iwasawa decomposition and Cartan decomposition are just coming from these familiar coordinates, elementary coordinates in complex analysis. So that is consideration of the unit disk in complex case, what we can do in other situation. So, and as it usually appear in our course, situation technically is identical if we replace corresponding imaginary unit by the from complex imaginary unit to dual or double numbers. So let's first consider the corresponding hyperbolic case with double numbers. So instead of a matrix with Kelly transform with I, so instead of this matrix, we just pick up matrix with double numbers imaginary unit J. This time we need to introduce this minus sign here. Just without this minus sign, determinant of this matrix will be zero. So we need non-degenerate matrix, non-singular matrix. So minus sign shall appear in this place. And when there is the corresponding transformation, if we will do similar conjugation by this matrix with J, we will again have this representation of SL2R, where A and B in a different font will be corresponding double numbers. And if we structurally consider what happened here, then it's turned out what action of corresponding subgroup is normalized, diagonalized here. So unfortunately, this picture in this presentation does not reflect the rotational property. So previously, we diagonalized the subgroup K with matrices cosine omega, sine omega, minus sine omega, cosine omega. Now, if we do the hyperbolic Kelly transform and consider the fixed group of the double imaginary unit, this subgroup is denoted in our course before as A prime. So it's here. So that is fixed group for double imaginary number. It consists of cosine t, sine t, sine t, cosine t. So if that matrix hyperbolic t, sine hyperbolic t, cosine hyperbolic t will be just conjugated by 1j minus j1, 1j minus j1, then result will be just diagonal matrix e to the power j t 0 0 a minus j t. And corresponding transformation will be hyperbolic rotations. So it will be just hyperbolic rotations for the that domain. So we will have, like, instead circles, we will have fixed orbits which are parabolas. Unfortunately, we had today power loss in my building in Leeds, and I was not able to upload refreshed files for these lectures, which contain more relevant representation of this diagonalization. But we may again compare action of SL2R on the upper half plane in the previous slides with action with action after Möbius transformation. Again, none of that, so action of subgroup A itself is not very spectacular, but it's subgroup A prime instead, which is diagonalized. So A prime is diagonalized in this Kelly transform. And here we have action of subgroup N and K correspondingly. They are also not particularly transparent, but it's not the purpose of this Kelly transform. It's subgroup A prime, which need to be better in the transformation. But what we see as a significant difference between what we had before with SL2R and what we have now. Previously, we actually have an inequality what these points in SL2R representation in the complex numbers, which belong to the complex unit disk, had absolute value less than one. So we have just interior part of the unit disk. But in hyperbolic case, we are not able to derive similar inequality like that anymore. Actually, what after such transformation we can obtain, we only have the representation what A inverse B in absolute value is different from one. So boundary of the unit is not included, but both points with bigger value and lesser value than one, they are permitted. So actually, that is rather significant fact, and what it means for us has different interpretation. In geometry, that means what we cannot anymore split the plane by the unit circle into the interior part, which is unit disk, and exterior part, which is its complement. So on the hyperbolic situation, actually points can escape that. So we cannot anymore say what our unit disk is just domain in between of two hyperbolas. So not only so these points are included in hyperbolic unit disk, not only these points are included, by exterior points are included as well. This is actually already was possible to trace from one of my previous lectures when we discuss action of SL2R. In particular, we spoke what it can be given by such rotations of the cone, but if that cone is considered, that cone is actually is two-sided, and so if you watch particular generatrix of the cone, straight line, it's two-sided line, so it's intersect this plane in the lower half plane, then it's make a half turn, and then the same generatrix intersect this vertical plane in the upper half plane. So in this way, lower half plane is not invariant under Möbius transformation with double numbers. So that is an element which we somehow did not treat it properly before. What upper half plane is Möbius is invariant set only for complex and dual numbers. For double numbers, it's possible to make a translation, a transition from upper half plane to lower half plane by a continuous set of transformation. So we are not separated by the unit circle. That has a consequence for corresponding function theories, because when we are speaking about separation of sets, unit disk and its complementary part, when we have corresponding decomposition of the Hardy space. So if we consider L2 space on the unit circle, I denoted by letter T, so all square integrable function, it's turned out what its function, which are analytic inside of circle in the unit disk, and has L2 continuation to the unit circle. It's called Hardy space. So function which are analytic inside and have L2 continuation. And its orthogonal complement, which is really means what we have function which are analytic outside of the unit circle and have L2 continuation to the lower half plane. So it's turned out what with two spaces just of function on the unit circle is images of corresponding geometrical sets. So we can make extension of function in either inside or outside direction. For double numbers, if we will try to build corresponding spaces of analytic function, such decomposition is not possible just because sets are not separated by the unit circle. So something need to be done. And finally, there is physical consequence what past and the future in the hyperbolic case can be continuously transformed one into another. So again, I recall what collection of points on the of the double numbers that so means we have here. Say horizontal direction time, that will be space. This one is light cone, which separate space time and space like and time like intervals. And so what shared it here is time like intervals. So intervals which are means what we have certain causal precedence between points, endpoints of this interval. And then there is, for this decomposition, further split of these two parts of the light cone into future part and past part. So from our everyday experience, we know what future and the past are different. We have knowledge about past, but we cannot change it anymore. And we do not have knowledge about our future, but hopefully our actions are able to change our future. So that is physically rather different type of points here. So on the left and on the right. And we somehow, again, from our daily experience, do not expect what there is a possibility to jump between future and the past. And here there is the illustration of a set of Möbius transformation which map the future part of the light cone, so it's shadowed by collection of hyperbolas. And when there is a certain continuous family of Möbius transformation which continuously maps that future part of the light cone to its complement past part of the light cone. So here is just six short from the continuous family of transformation. And so we probably can watch that transformation in a different style. So here we have both parts which are future and the past, but they are inside of unit interval. If you see here, there is the bold red hyperbola that is representing and representing boundary of the unit disk, hyperbolic unit disk. It's a unit circle hyperbolic. So if we will watch it in dynamic, so maybe I need to play it slowly, so just step by step. So how it's going up and down. So as you see, gradually inner part of points from the inner part of the unit circle escape to outer part of the unit circle. So we have that gradual transformation to the complement. And then after full rotation, these points return back to the inner part of the circle after they were outside. So what it may look like, what points at just crossing the unit circle. So we have here like a transition of this point, so where it intersects. But it's not true. If we will watch every individual point, it never approach or pass the unit circle. Actually, every individual point goes up to infinity, and then at the infinity, it appear on the other side of the unit circle. So just maybe next picture, we'll try to explain it better. So here we have two copies of the upper half plane, two copies of the dual numbers plane. So it's square A, C, A prime, C prime, and square A double prime, C prime, A prime, C double prime. So here are two squares, two identical copies of our double plane numbers, and that boundaries of these two squares is actually the light cone at infinity. So it's bound our plane. And what happened with the point under transformation which was shown on previous slide, that point approach light cone at infinity, it's past light cone at infinity and appear on the lower side of the plane. So here we have upper side, upper half plane, and the second copy we have lower half plane. So if we will watch the transition, so that will be just the picture which we want. Or on the same copy, if we will want to represent the behavior of unit disk, corresponding unit disk, so here is again two identical copies of the dual double numbers plane. So we have here interior part of the unit circle and here unit hyperbola and here exterior part, and we are glued in such a way that we have continuous transposability of continuous transformation from interior part to exterior part passing the light cone at infinity. And actually that a kind of a resolution of this problem. So because what we've seen on this slide where we are able to transform future into past, this is a kind of non-physical transformation which we need to avoid. And that is avoided by the introduction of this double cover. So this is a double cover for the double number plane. So two copies are representing, and when we appears on the wrong side, either on the lower half plane or on the exterior of the unit disk, we are simply saying what we are on a different copy of the double number plane. And in order to make this picture working, we have here to glue together points with the same letters regardless of the number of dashes attached to them. So all A's need to be glued together, all C's need to be glued together, and corresponding intervals, so interval from A to C double prime, need to be glued together with intervals from A prime C and A prime double prime C prime. So if you will try to glue with intervals together, so you will see what we will not obtain something simple like torus. Instead, we will get one-sided surface, which is known as cross cup. There is a Wikipedia article about that surface. This is a close relative of the Möbius strip. You probably know Möbius strip, which has just one side, and but it has boundary. Cross cup is again one-sided surface without boundary. So it's there is a representation in three-dimensional space with two-dimensional surface cannot be presented without self-intersection, but in higher dimension it's possible. So, and that is important object. So actually that solution with double cover really appears in connection to something important, which is known as a redshift. So you're probably aware what spectral lines of chemical elements rather stable, and we are able to identify chemical elements by their spectral lines, by the light color of the light which is emitted by these elements. And when we compare spectral lines coming from our sun and spectral line or our laboratories, and when spectral lines coming from for chemical elements coming from far stars, it's turned out what spectral lines from remote galactics is shifted towards the red part of the spectrum. And that usually explained, and again, if you look in Wikipedia, there is like explanation here due to Big Bang theory, expanding universe, and saying what our galaxies are running away each other, and when we have Doppler effect and so on. But it's turned out what that description is not very accurate, and Irving Siegel published in 1970 a book, and afterward he get a, some further papers till year 1998, I think, where here he proved what Doppler effect is not accurately representing that redshift of spectral lines, and much more accurate picture appeared if we look into the universe which possess conformal invariance. Conformal invariance for universe means what we have all Lorentz space-time symmetries, but on top of that we add inversion, so that full conformal group of transformation for space-time may explain the redshift observed in astronomy. But when we add the inversion, this is that transformation which send future to the past, which is not physical, and to resolve that item we need to say really what there is a second copy, second sheet of double cover with opposite direction of space-time, and then we just glue them together in a similar way to get a resolution of this item. So just to conclude and compare with previous pictures, if you remember in the previous part of the course we said what compactification of the hyperbolic dual number planes, double number plane can be done by such a hyperboloid, and we need to have corresponding stereographic projection, and light cone at infinity is represented by these two cross lines. So double cover in compactification will look like that. We have these two copies of hyperboloid, and if we will just glue these two copies over where light's cone at infinity. So we will get accurate representation, which for this double cover, which will be Möbius invariant and still separate upper and lower half plane or interior and exterior part of the unit disk. Then for parabolic unit disk, we can do the similar transformation. This time matrix may be shall contain these elements from the imaginary unit for dual numbers epsilon, and this transformation may become either with plus, minus, or even zero in this position. So we can even put zero in this position. In any case, determinant will be different from zero, so matrix is not singular. And we have correspondingly three types of parabolic unit circle, like this parabola with upper part filled down and lower directing parabolas. And actually, there is the continuous set of transformation between all unit disks, almost continuous, or so unifying presentation. So this is our pictures for complex unit disks, complex numbers. Here there are three types of transformation for parabolic case. So in the middle, we have upper half plane appearing just as particular case of parabolic Kelly transform. So it's identical shift by number one. And then we have further transformation between parabolic and hyperbolic unit disk. So in this case, we again obtain a certain unification between all three situations. So the difference is what upper half plane is universal object, which nicely work for complex Möbius transformation, dual and double numbers. But if we move to the unit disk, which has its own advantages, but we don't have a universal representation for each case, geometry of the unit disk is different. If the shape of the upper half plane is the same as it was during entire our course, then for unit disk we have this difference between shapes.